Professor Rajagopal.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah. Okay. This is another, you know, so the elegant speaker who is actually, you know, so going to take the floor. So the Professor Rajagopal, the Professor K. Rajagopal. So the Professor Rajagopal is a professor of civil engineering and institute chair at IIT Madras. So he has been teaching at IIT Madras since 1993. His areas of research are geosynthetics, reinforced soil structures, finite element analysis in geomechanics, construction in soft grounds. He had guided several graduate students for their master's and doctoral programs. And Professor Rajagopal has served as head of the department of the Department of Civil Engineering at IIT Madras. He had served as the president of the Indian chapter of International Geosynthetics Society, and also served as a board member of International Geosynthetics for 8 long years, from 2010 to 2018. And Professor Rajagopal is an associate editor for Indian Geotechnical Journal, as well as Geotextiles and Geomembranes Journal. He had provided consultancy services for several challenging projects related to very high geosynthetic soil retaining walls, steep geosynthetic soil embankments, tunneling, and ground improvement projects in soft clays. Today, we are fortunate to listen to his talk on geosynthetics encased granular columns, design and analysis under vertical and lateral loads. Professor Rajagopal, you know, Siddha, you have the 25 minutes. So if you complete it early, it will be very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Rao. The first speaker had a full 35 minutes, second 30 minutes. Now we made it only 25 minutes. Well, anyway, I'll try to compensate the time. So very good morning to everyone. I wish I could have given this lecture in person at Vizag. It didn't happen. Then at least I wanted to give this lecture from my office. That could not happen because of the reasons that you have been reading in the newspapers. So I'm giving this finally from my home. And anyway, it is a pleasure to share some ideas with all of you. So this particular topic, before that, would like to thank two of my students, Jaipal. He is my current PhD student, and then Sunil. He finished his PhD some 3 years back. And this particular talk is on how to utilize the granular columns encased with geosynthetics for construction in extremely soft clays. And I think I will skip most of my slides for lack of time. And I'm going to discuss the construction in extremely soft clays that have a cohesion of less than 5 kPa, 2 to 3 kPa. And they all have very low bearing capacity. And if you stand on them, you'll just simply sink. That is the large settlements. And then they also undergo very large lateral flows. I will explain them through some pictures. And here, you'll see a very nice temple from Odisha. This particular one is from my student Sunil from his hometown. See here, there's a temple and it started tilting, similar to our Leaning Tower of Pisa. And here you have this Kissing Towers. This is actually, it's a classical photograph from Manitoba, Canada. And this particular one is from Vizag. It's actually, here is a road embankment being constructed and it has undergone a deep-seated failure, slip circle failure. And so where do we come across this type of challenging soils? Actually, some examples are here, the Airbus factory in Germany, Kansa International Airport that was built in Japan, Changi Airport, Singapore, and then Mumbai. It is underlain by very thick soft clay deposit, marine deposit, and I do have a lot of slides from Mumbai, but I did not put them in here because of lack of time. I'll just show you something about the Kansai International Airport. Actually, this particular one, the airport was built in the ocean, the middle of the ocean, about 2 to 3 kilometers away from the coast. First, they outlined this, then they built an island. And this island was built in about 10 to 20 meters depth of water. And the estimated settlement is about 10 meters. And by now, it has sunk by more than 10 meters. And this is the support system that they proposed. And here you see a real picture. This I took during my trip to Osaka in 2005. Here you see this breakwater units, and then this is the key wall that is protecting the island. And here you see a schematic. And actually, one interesting thing is most of the construction was done by robotically controlled apparatus. You see, everything is precisely controlled, and the dumpers and then the compactors, everything they're monitored from a remote terminal. Then they were able to do the construction. And so here you see Dr. Balakumar. And actually the problem in Kansai Airport is the liquefaction. And they installed about 1 million meter length of PVDs and then sand columns. And then this is the soil dump for forming the offshore island. And actually, they used a lot of varieties of soil improvement methods at this particular site, including the PVDs. And here you see a pit formed by dynamic compaction. And then, of course, the sand columns and so on. And the very interesting thing is the entire terminal building was supported on hydraulic jacks, so that even if there is a differential settlement, you can operate these jacks and then maintain the level. It's a beautiful arrangement that they have at this international airport. And actually, there are a very large number of ground improvement techniques. One simple one that geotechnical engineers have been using is the pre-consolidation, initially by using sand drains. And the principle is you reduce the drainage path length so that you can get faster consolidation. And to overcome the problems with the sand drains, people have come out with geotextile drains that's called as prefabricated vertical drains. Actually, they have a core, a drainage core, and then a filter. And then here you have all these PVDs that are installed at the site. And an improvement on the PVDs is vacuum pre-consolidation. There are different varieties. And by using the vacuum, we can achieve much faster consolidation. What could happen within about 6 months, you can achieve it within about 2 to 3 weeks with vacuum. And then other thing is, of course, the sand columns or the aggregate columns. These columns are used as load-bearing elements, and these are confined with by the clay soil that's surrounding here. And a long time back, this problem was worked out. And theoretically, it is proved that the maximum pressure that you can apply on these granular columns is only about 8 times Cu. And if Cu is very low, then obviously you cannot apply any pressure on these columns. And that is where you require an additional support. And that is done in the form of encased granular columns. And here the principle is very simple. You have a column of granular material, either made of soil, or the sand, or aggregate. Then it is encased within a tube of a geosynthetic, either a geotextile or a geogrid, depending on the type of fill material that we use. And when you confine this, the geosynthetic exerts a lateral confining pressure, because obviously the applied pressure tries to expand the soil. In the process, the geosynthetic goes into tension and then it applies hoop stress, and that's the principle. And here you see the treatment of soft clay at Airbus A380 factory in Hamburg, Germany. And this entire soil is more like a slush. It could be having a cohesion of about 2 to 3 kilopascals, and it's very, very low, like it's almost like a liquid. And the structures were supported by sand-filled columns. And here you see the geotextile column of 1 meter diameter filled with sand. And these were used for constructing this island. And here you see a schematic of how you form these columns. Very simple, like most of these clays, they're so soft that you can use vibration or just a simple push. You can push a hollow pipe and then introduce our the geosynthetic column. And this particular one is from a German company. It's called Ringtrack. Fill it with sand or aggregate, and then finally remove the pipe, and then you end up with this column. And here you see another geosynthetic encased column made of geogrid. And here they could make a borehole in advance and then introduce this. And here also you see another geogrid encased column. And this geogrid encasement helps in improving both the stiffness and then the strength. And then more importantly, if you encase it within a geotextile, that would also act as a good filter. And in the long run, the aggregate will have better properties. And how do we install them? Like, we can install these columns either in a triangular pattern or a square pattern or a hexagonal pattern. Among these three, the hexagonal pattern is not become very popular because of the construction issues, and the square and the triangles, they are very common. And the entire analysis is done based on a unit cell modeling that I will explain a bit later. And here you see a plot between the spacing to diameter ratio on the x-axis, and then the area replacement ratio is basically, this area replacement ratio is related to the volume of aggregate that we are going to use at the site. And when we any natural material, we would like to minimize this. What's the best we can get with the least amount of natural material, because environmentally it is sustainable. And so for a given spacing to diameter ratio, the triangular pattern has the maximum area replacement ratio, and then square very close to that, then hexagonal is much lower. And so actually we can say for the same area replacement ratio, the triangles can be provided at the maximum spacing. And so it's actually our object is how to design the system so that we use the least material but get the best performance. And for that, we have to go through the design. And only the German design code, the FGO, he has implemented the geosynthetic encased columns, because the Germans, they had implemented this at several in several of their projects. And the basis for FGO goes back to one paper by Reitel and Kempfert. Basically, they consider the equilibrium of a soil composite consisting of a column, a geosynthetic, and then the clay. within a unit cell, and then because of the higher stiffness, the uniform pressure that is applied on the soil is large part of it is transferred into the column, and the smaller part into the soil. And actually, I'm not going to go through the equations because it becomes boring and we don't have much time. And basically, by considering the equilibrium between the entire system and assuming that the settlement on the column and on the soil are equal, that is, by transferring lesser pressure into the soil, we can get this condition, and then we can come out with the design. And some of the design parameters in the FZO, the major parameters are the constraint modulus or the odometer modulus, DS, friction angle of the aggregate, diameter of the column, area replacement ratio, geosynthetic modulus, Poisson's ratio, K0. And by considering all these parameters and the equations, it's a trial and error procedure. You cannot just do one single calculation. And we get a settlement improvement factor. In fact, the design of all these granular columns is to limit the settlements, because the settlements are the major design considerations, because these soft clays, they undergo very, very large settlements and their bearing capacity is very small. And so this settlement improvement factor is the one that's going to govern the design. And here you see some results. I'm not explaining the procedure on how to do this, but if you are interested, you can read the paper. And here you see the influence of the diameter of granular column on the settlement improvement factor. And when we have the ordinary granular columns without any encasement, this is from hexagonal, square, and triangle. It's actually for all the diameters. And here in this analysis, the spacing to diameter ratio is kept constant at 2.5. And the response for the ordinary columns is more or less the same. There is not much difference. But when it comes to encased columns, the triangular columns, triangular arrangement gives the best performance for the given ratio and then given diameter and then this given spacing. And the hexagonal gives much lesser improvement. Then as the diameter is increasing, the performance decreases. That's because as the diameter of the column is increasing, for a limited axial strain, and the hoop force in the geosynthetic reduces, and the influence of the geosynthetic goes on reducing as you increase the diameter. And so that's the reason why we get a lesser thing. So here we have the influence of the spacing diameter ratio. And typically, all these treatments, they use a spacing to diameter ratio of about 2.5 to 3. But with the geosynthetic encasement, we can increase the spacing to almost 3.5. And by using stiffer geosynthetic, we can increase this the settlement improvement factor even further compared to what we have here. And here is actually the influence of the constraint modulus. And as the soil is becoming stiffer and stiffer, that is with a higher constraint modulus, you see the effect of geosynthetic comes down, obviously, because the soil itself can stand on its own. And here you have the influence of the friction angle that is used in the granular columns. The improvement increases exponentially because there is a KP factor, and that mobilizes a larger hoop forces and then hoop tension force, and then I get more improvement. And similarly, the modulus of the geosynthetic has got a very large influence. And so there's another method that's the BIS method, that's 15-84. And this is originally published in 2003 for ordinary granular columns. I think I'll quickly go through the capacity of a unit cell is written in terms of three load quantities. The capacity of the stone columns are due to confinement from the soil, and the capacity of the stone column are due to surcharge pressure that is applied on the soil, and then the capacity of the intervening soil because of its own bearing capacity. And this Q1 is related to the lateral pressure that's exerted, and so the sigma RL is the confining pressure that is related to the overburden pressure plus 4Cu. Is actually 4Cu is we can think of it as a bearing capacity in the radial direction. And so here we have the Q2 is the bearing capacity of the column because of the surcharge that could be applied on the soil. This delta sigma R is actually from the Q-safe, that is the safe bearing capacity on the soil. And this radial pressure is the average pressure. And then the Q3 is the pressure that you can apply on the soil itself. And we can equate Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 to the pressure applied on a unit cell area and get our spacing. And we can modify this equation, because basically the radial pressure that's exerted by the soil is going to be added upon by the geosynthetic confinement. And so actually this delta sigma 3 is the additional confining pressure that is given by the hoop stresses that are developed in the geosynthetic. And this particular one, this equation is from Henkel and Gilbert's analysis. That's a very classic paper in 1952, wherein they related the hoop strain to the axial strain like this. And then by multiplying with the modulus of the geosynthetic, we can get our stress. And this particular equation is derived based on the incompressible column. Like, we assume that as the volume, the column is compressing, its volume does not change. And the same assumption was also made in MZO. And so this, and then of course the K naught is also used in the MZO code, because we require to calculate the lateral pressure exerted by the surrounding soil. So the parameters are not too different. The approach is similar, whether it is FZO code or the IS code. And so here we need to assume some value for epsilon A. And typical values could be anywhere from 2 to 5% depending on your allowable settlements. And by adding this delta sigma 3 in the IS code, we can generalize this to the geosynthetic encased the columns, and some parametric analysis. This is for 750 millimeter diameter column, and with the different area ratios. So this is the settlement improvement factor. And at the bottom, you see the result by Preeby. Preeby is, all of you know, that he did a lot of work on the stone columns. And at the limit, as the geosynthetic modulus tends to zero, you get same response. Okay, this is for triangular pattern, this is for square, then hexagonal pattern. And then the influence of the geosynthetic modulus. And I think I will skip this. Then how do both of these methods compare with other data? And there's one paper published by in 2005, wherein there's an excellent summary by from different field tests. And the x-axis here you see the area replacement ratio, and the y-axis, the settlement reduction factor or settlement improvement factor. So actually, this is the data from different. Sorry, I think I don't want to do that. This is the data from different sites, mostly in Germany. And then this is for this particular one. I hope you can see the entire screen, but on my screen, the top is blinded by the zoom controls. So the solid symbols, they refer to ordinary granular columns, and then the open symbols, they refer to geosynthetic encased columns. And this entire data is actually, it is presented and there are some regression lines. This particular line is for ordinary stone columns, and this particular one is for a geogrid having a low modulus in the range of 1000 to 2000 kilonewton per meter. And this particular line is for encased columns with a higher geosynthetic modulus of about 2000 to 3000. And these data points, they are from the current analysis. The green ones, they are from FGO. And these orange ones, they are from IS code methods. And you see that at all the different area replacement ratios for the ordinary columns, these are exactly matching with the regression line that is proposed based on the field and laboratory test data. So that means that this procedure is good. Like for ordinary columns, it is exactly matching with other observations. And this particular one, these bottom lines are for geosynthetic modulus of 1,500 kilonewton per meter. And you see that they are very close to within the range of measurements. And the upper one is for modulus of 2,500. And you see that this comparison is given for three different area ratios, 10%, 15%, and 20%. And usually, with the geosynthetic encasement, the area replacement ratio is not more than about 15%. Beyond that, it is not necessary. And you see, within this range, the comparison is excellent. And of course, at a higher area replacement ratio, you tend to get a difference. But then we don't really use this in the field.
Professor Rajagopal?
Yeah.
Could you conclude it?
Okay. Yeah, thanks for the reminder. Otherwise, I'll just go on forever. Okay. So here, actually, this is an imagination, like I would say imagination, in terms of the stiffness. So if you have a rigid concrete pile, this is the stiffness that you can get. And if you have a homogeneous soil, the clay, you'll have very flexible thing. And by using the ordinary granular column, you can increase the stiffness a little bit. And by using encasement, you can go closer and closer to the rigid piles. That is what we have seen in the earlier cases. Okay, I think I will just spend two more minutes, not spend much time. Actually, the benefit of these encased columns is more when our columns are subjected to shear loading. And here, one of my former students, Sunil, he did the work on large-scale direct shear box tests. And then the one thing that he observed is that with encasement, there's a strain hardening. That is, as you are subjecting the system to lateral straining, the system is becoming stiffer. And that's good because then our system is not going to undergo the failure. And this is the schematic of where you can get very large shear deformations near to the toe, where there is a where there is a likelihood of the entire column shearing off. And when we provide the geosynthetic encasement, the system can become stiffer. And this was analyzed through computer simulation. This is by using a FLAC program, FLAC 3D program. Here, this is the entire 3D schematic of the system, and I'll not go through. And here, with ordinary stone columns, the columns have deformed, whereas with encasement, they were able to stand very well. And what was originally a deep-seated failure, it has become more like a toe failure because of the encasement. And the result of this, in terms of, I'll skip all this, in terms of the factor of safety, because that is what a geotechnical engineer looks for, because of the soft nature of the soil, it's only 10 kPa. And with the different area replacement ratios, the maximum factor of safety that you can get with ordinary granular columns is only 1. Whereas with the geosynthetic encasement, you get with the higher modulus, so we can increase the factor of safety. And you see that even geosynthetic having a modulus of 2,500, the factor of safety is more or less constant. And then it's actually with about 8 to 12% area replacement ratio, the factor of safety is 1.29. That you cannot achieve even with about 25% area replacement ratio for the ordinary granular columns. So that's the advantage of this geosynthetic encasement. I think I'll just conclude. And the beauty of this system is it is both FGO and then the IS code equations, so they compare very well with the field and laboratory test data. And in fact, the FGO code is very frequently used in all the German design codes. And we can modify our existing IS code for the geosynthetic encasement. And we do get very large improvement. And with geosynthetic encasement, the entire column becomes stiff, and we promote more of soil arching. Basically, it is the soil arching that is transferring higher load from the embankments into the column because of the difference in the stiffness between the column and the surrounding soil. So I think with this, I'll stop. And thanks to several funding agencies. And at this time, I'd like to remember my former student, late Murugesan. He was the one who did the initial work that was done in the early 2000s, like 2003 to 2006. Unfortunately, he passed away. But several other students, they continued this work. And so I would like to acknowledge all the former students, and especially Dr. Murugesan. And so thank you very much.
Another question, Dr. Bagli to Rajagopal. I'll just take one question. He says, why do you consider KP while calculating the capacity? Because it requires considerable deformation. Why not K naught? Isn't K naught appropriate? Can give a quick answer, Professor Rajagopal.
You're muted, Rajagopal.
Rajagopal is muted.
Organizers, okay. Yeah, now I think I'm back. Yeah. My speech is back. It's a very good question, but maybe we could discuss later. There is a very large factor of safety put in. It's true that we require large deformation, but then KP divided by about 3. So it might be within the working range.